Good morning, everybody. How's everyone doing this morning? I just want to just say, man, it's so good to see all of us in the house. I know that, you know, the holiday season is upon us, and it's a season where we're all going to get even busier, and you're busy right now. So give yourselves a hand for being in the house in the midst of a very difficult, busy season. And it's only going to get busier, isn't that true? And so I just want to, right up front, just remind us that as, you know, we engage in this holiday season, that we not put God on the side. Can I hear an amen to that? But we make sure that we're in the house to worship God, and that we're not skipping out on our grace groups. I mean, the reality is we have 15 services, say 15 services, over five locations, that's right, where that all throughout the week where you can come and worship and hear the word, and so there's really no excuse for us not to be in the house. And so we're telling everyone, hey, make your plans in advance, and not just for yourself, but think about the people that you're inviting, that you're believing that God is going to touch during this season, that pick the service that is best for them, and let's make sure that we're in the house to keep on honoring God throughout this holiday season. Amen? I mean, after all, He is the reason for the season, right? And He's the reason for every season. And we also have about 380 grace groups, so I'm pretty sure there's one that will fit every single one of us if you're not yet connected. Well, as Chad said, we're continuing our series this morning, and what a tumultuous couple of weeks it's been in our country. Isn't that true? I hesitate to open up my Facebook nowadays because I'm afraid of what I might see is happening someplace in the world. But the reality is this. We live in a time where it's more important than ever that the church really be the church of Jesus Christ. Do you agree with that? More than ever, the world needs to see the gospel not just talked about, but lived out in the life of Christians. I mean, probably for the first time since the first century, is Christianity looked at with such a negative stereotype. Isn't that true? Where Christians are often looked at as being bigots or racist or whatever you want to call it, or ignorant and primitive. And now more than ever, we can't just talk about the gospel. We have to demonstrate it with our lives. That the world would see not a bunch of people that are judgmental and alienate others, but rather a bunch of people that actually try to live like Jesus lived. Because we realize that what it means to be a Christian doesn't mean that we just attend services and we give our tithes and all that stuff, which is necessary. But what Christian really means is that we live like Jesus. And we carry ourselves and we relate to other people the way that Jesus did. In fact, in the very beginning, the term Christian was actually a derogatory term. People looked at these followers and they said, man, you're just like that Jesus guy. You're a Christian. And it was a negative thing that they said. Because the Christians were living so much like Jesus. They were forgiving people. They were generous. They were taking care of widows, taking care of poor people. I mean, they were loving other people. And they said, man, you're so loving. You're like that Jesus guy. What's wrong with you? When was the last time you and I were accused of being like that Jesus guy? Man, you're always forgiving people. What's wrong with you? You know, you're always generous. How come you're generous? You know, when was the last time we were accused of being like Jesus, even to a negative degree? See, the reality is the world needs to see Christians live like Jesus more than ever. And if you're here this morning and you're a Christian, yeah, that's us. That's me. I realize more every time I look at what's going on in the world, I realize, man, I have to represent Jesus more than ever everywhere that I go. And if you're here this morning and you're not yet a Christian, please understand that's what it means, that we want to be like Jesus, who loved and served and gave and sacrificed himself for the cause of others. Amen. And this morning, I want to talk to us about a message called the test, because before God can use us, he always tests us. Now, I hate tests. Anybody here like tests? I hate them. But you know, here's the thing about the test that God does. See, a lot of times when we think of tests, we think of it as a pass-fail kind of thing. Oh, you did bad, you're out because you failed the test. But the reality is, in God's eyes, tests are meant to reveal the reality of what's going on in our lives. It's meant to work some stuff out of us that doesn't belong. And it's also meant to work some things into us that does belong. I've shared before, I just started assistant coaching soccer at Pearl City High School. And we had our first preseason game yesterday against Punahou. And we got destroyed, to put it lightly. I would tell you the score, but I don't want to. It was bad. It was really, really bad. And what we tried to encourage the guys after, I mean, Punahou's defending state champions, okay? Pearl City is not. So that's just what it is. But our kids are good. Beside the point. And we got destroyed. And what we tried to encourage the boys about after is preseason games are good. Losing is not a bad thing because it's meant to reveal your weakness. Now we know what we need to work on before the season starts. Now we know what we need to do on Monday and on Tuesday and on Wednesday to get you ready for the next thing. And that's what the testing of God does. It's meant to reveal our weaknesses so that we can work on it, so that we're ready for the game of life and the situations that God wants to place us in to be Jesus in that moment. And a lot of times we look at tests and we go, no, I don't want God to reveal what's going wrong in me. Well, then the reality is if we don't know what we need to work on, then we can't work on it, and we can't improve, and we can't be the people that God is calling us to be. So before God launches us out into his purpose, he always tests us. Turn to your neighbor and says, he always tests us. We see here in Luke chapter 4, God even allowed Jesus to walk through some testings. And if God allowed Jesus to walk through some testings, well, then for sure he's going to allow us to walk through some testings. And we pick it up here in Luke chapter 4, starting in verse 1. And it says this, it's up on screen and in your notes. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted. For 40 days he was tempted or tested by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. Everybody say hungry. Man, I'm hungry after 40 minutes. I can't even imagine going 40 days without food. I wouldn't just be hungry, I'd be hangry, okay? Verse 3, the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. He's testing and tempting Jesus in the area of his appetites. And this, look at Jesus' response in verse 4. It is written, man shall not live on bread alone. The first test that we see that is common to all of us is we're going to be tested in our appetites. We will all be tested in our appetites. What do I mean by appetites? I mean, what we see here in this passage that Jesus was hungry. And the devil said, hey, well, you're hungry. You've been fasting and praying. You've been denying your flesh. Why don't you just use your godhood, your power, and turn this stone into bread? You can do it. Now, let me ask you a question. Is bread bad? If you're gluten-free, yes. But if for the most of us, bread is not a bad thing. We say, yeah, of course, I'm hungry. I need some bread, right? What is wrong with that? And the devil tested him and tempted him to disobey God and to disobey what he knew was the right thing to do and to really follow what he wanted. And so while bread is not necessarily a bad thing, giving in to the temptation of the enemy is, right? And you see, a lot of times, sin is not just, you know, obvious evil stuff. I mean, it is. But it can also be taking a good thing and using it outside of the boundaries that God has established, right? They think about food is a good thing, right? But if we use food to excess, it can become a bad thing, right? If we use food for comfort or whatever it is, it goes beyond the boundaries of sustaining us, and it can become a bad thing. I never understood the term comfort food until I really needed some comfort food, and then the food comforted me. I was like, wow, that was pretty comforting. Food can be used in a way that is outside the way that God intended it to be used, right? And when we take something good and we use it outside of its God-given boundaries, it can become a bad thing. Think about this. I we're playing flag football one day, and I sliced my finger open. Some dude was wearing track cleats. Kalai, you remember that? Blood was gushing. I check people's shoes. But anyway, he stepped on my finger, and then boom, blood was everywhere. So I had to go get stitches, and that was one of the most painful moments of my life. Because I'm a wimp, anyway, and they had to stitch me up. I went home, and they gave me a bottle of Vicodin. Now, I was in love with that bottle of Vicodin because I was in so much pain. And when you take the pill, it's amazing what happens. Those of you know what I'm talking about, the pain goes away, and you're just kind of chilling. I don't care that there's a big gash in my hand. I'm feeling pretty good right now, right? So how many of us know that medication used in the right way can be a good thing? But it can also be used in excess, and it can become a bad thing. And some of us have experienced that. See, a good thing used outside of God's boundaries can become a bad thing. Another example would be sex, right? God designed sex. That's how you and I got here, right? Pretty sure, at least. Without that, we wouldn't be here. I'm dreading the day when I'm going to have to explain that to my kids. Anyway, I know it's coming soon because they're starting to wonder. But anyway, I'll ask for your advice, those of you that are older and wiser. But, you know, sex is a good thing. God designed it to solidify two people in marriage and also for procreation. It's a good thing, but when we use it outside of God's boundaries, it can become a bad thing. We can really hurt people with that. Outside of the boundaries of marriage, man, we can destroy our marriages and our relationships and our families. See, God designs things to be used in the right way, and when they're used in the right way, it's a good thing. But see, we'll all be tested in the area of our appetites to use good things in the wrong way, outside of God's boundaries. And when we fail in the area of the test of our appetites, there can be very negative consequences to that. Isn't that true? And many of us have seen the ramifications of that. We've grown up in families and households where good things were used in the wrong way and it became a bad thing. And we grew up dealing with the hurts and the consequences of other people's appetites gone wrong. Isn't that true? And so all of us are going to be tested in the area of our appetites. And if we don't pass those tests, our ability to share the gospel and to demonstrate the gospel is severely hindered. Isn't that true? So someone once asked me, you know, what was your most embarrassing moment? And, you know, I got saved when I was in high school, so I didn't do the crazy things. But one of the things I do remember doing, I was the captain of our soccer team when I was in high school. And a bunch of girls wanted to go see this movie called Titanic. And if you remember the movie Titanic, yeah, Leo and Kate and, you know, that whole thing. There was room on the door, by the way. She just let him sink. But anyway, right, I mean, just pull him up. Like, come on. Don't let go. Anyway. And so they said, hey, let's go watch the movie Titanic. Problem is, I had soccer practice. So I decided to lie to the coach. And I said, coach, I have a family thing. I can't come to practice tonight. And I went to go see the movie. You know, it was a decent movie, right? Here's what I didn't count on. About half the girls' soccer team was also at that movie. And somebody snitched on me to my coach. Because I go to practice the next day. Oh, how was your family dinner? Oh, it was good. Yeah. How was the movie? I was like, I don't know what you're talking about. Anyway, I got a lecture in front of the whole team, and it was bad, and I ended up sitting out the next game. That was pretty bad. But here's what was worse than that, was one of my teammates came up to me after, as we were walking off, he was like, oh, I thought you go church. Don't you hate that? And I wanted to say, man, make like you don't do worse stuff than that. I just went to see Titanic, you know? Let it go. But here's the thing. I realized in that moment, I gave in to my appetite, and it severely hindered my ability to be a witness for Christ to our teammates, to my teammates. Now, you know, the end of the story is I ended up marrying the girl, but, you know, whatever, many years later. Doesn't justify it, but does make it a little more worth it. But in that moment, giving in to that appetite, that desire for whatever it is, it creates a negative vibe around other people. And other people are watching the way that we live. And don't you hate when you do one little slip up, one little mess up, and they go, I thought you go to church. I thought you were a Christian. How could you do such a thing? And you're just like, really? Let's not go delve into your life now and talk about that. But here's the thing. People know instinctively that if we call ourselves followers of Jesus, that there should be a higher standard. Because there's the image of God, the Bible says in Romans chapter 1, is written on their hearts. And so they know when we say, man, I go to church, I love Jesus, I serve Jesus, instinctively people know, man, you're supposed to be living at a higher standard because God's already told them that. It's written on their heart. And when we don't, we can severely compromise our witness to the world and our ability to share the gospel with others around us. And that's partly why we're seeing what we're seeing in our country today, is because a lot of people talk about Jesus and they talk about loving people, but we don't actually do it. And instead what we see is the opposite. And what people end up doing is rejecting the gospel that they hear us talk about, but they don't see us live. Amen? And that's why God, because he loves us, allows us to walk through tests to surface areas in our heart where our appetites are out of control, where we don't have a grip on our appetite, so that we can get a grip on it, so that we can bring it to God and he can help us to manage that so that we can truly live out the gospel in our lives. You know, and all of us are going to go and be with our families in the next week, and we have an opportunity to really represent Jesus where we go. And I know sometimes that's the hardest place to do it, is around our family, right? Because they know us the best. And sometimes the relationships can be the most contentious at family gatherings. But that is the greatest opportunity that we have to demonstrate the love of Jesus and being accused, may we all be accused of being too much like Jesus. That they would see a difference in all of us. But we're all going to be tempted in the area of our appetites. You think about, you know, I thought it was funny. My youngest daughter is 9 months old now, and she just started eating solid food about a month ago. And when we first started feeding her, you know, those of you remember the first time you gave your baby some solid food, she didn't know what it was. She kind of freaked out. And then all of a sudden, she realized she liked it and that she couldn't wait for the next bite. She said, I just need more, you know? And she's the type. My other two were so, you know, they're so nice. They just kind of waited with their mouth open. This one, if you don't put the food in there at the right time, she yells at you. Wah! You know, I mean, she's like, whoa, sorry, it's coming. And she hasn't even finished swallowing that bite. She's just yelling at us again. The moment she sees the food, she starts kicking her leg, you know, like a rabbit. It's like this, you know, and okay, it's coming, you know. And it's cute when she does it. She can't control herself. Or you think about like a dog that gets so excited that the moment you open the can of food, right? Or they hear the scoop of the kibble and they come running to you. I had a dog once who got so excited every time he heard the food thing, he shook his tail so hard his whole butt just swung, you know? And he couldn't even walk because his butt was swinging because he's so excited, right? We have to get beyond being a baby where we can't control ourselves, or beyond being an animal that just by instinct reacts to our physical needs and desires. See, Jesus didn't give in to the temptation to turn the stone into the bread. Instead, what he did is he combated it with the word of God. Yes, I know I could do that. Yes, I know I could have sex with that person. Yes, I know I could give in to that temptation or that temptation or that temptation. But instead, God says, I'm not going to live on bread alone. That we don't live by just gratifying the needs of our flesh. I'm not a child that can't control herself. I'm not an animal that cannot control himself. I'm a child of God who is given a will and the Spirit of God to live in control of my passions and my desires. And watch this, when the world sees that, they see something totally different than what they're used to. Isn't that true? When we look at the way that the world is, why not have sex with whoever you can have sex with? Why not eat whatever you can eat? Why not do whatever you can do? Just gratify yourself, please your flesh, satisfy your appetites. That's the way our world lives. And when the world sees a group of people that says, no, we're not gonna live like that. We're not gonna live to gratify our flesh and satisfy our appetites. We're gonna live for God and God alone. At first they go, why? What's wrong with you? And hopefully that confusion will turn into interest to wanna know more. Because when they see people live different, it draws some curiosity about their God. Isn't that true? But if we live just like everybody else, it diminishes the power of the gospel. So Jesus overcame by not giving into his flesh, but by looking back at the word of God, which is another reason why we need to be in church on a regular basis, so that the word keeps on getting into us, so that we have the ability to overcome temptations. And we're going to have an awesome opportunity to practice that this afternoon, because we have Kamehameha Bakery donuts out in the lobby after service is over. See, there's nothing wrong with the one donut, or even the two. It's the 12 donuts that we got to watch out for, right? And so you're going to be tempted while you're talking and drinking your coffee to have not just one, not just two, and the conversation's good, but how about three? How about four? And in that moment, we have to decide, like, I need to control my appetite. So, you know, it's a little application after service this afternoon. You're welcome, and enjoy that donut. You can have three or four, right, Pastor Paris? How many did you have today? We won't talk about that. We won't talk about that. But we all have opportunities every day to control our appetites. And every time we do, every time we pass that test, we're preparing ourselves to be a witness for the gospel out in the world. Can I hear an amen to that? The second thing that we see here in this passage, after Jesus is tempted in food, and isn't it just like the devil? It doesn't just come at you with one thing. He comes at you with multiple things. And the second thing, the way that the devil tests Jesus and the way that he will test you and I, is he says this in verse 5, the devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I will give you all their authority and their splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will all be yours. Look at Jesus' reply. He said, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. I mean, think about that for just a moment. What if you were Jesus and you were offered all the authority in the world, all the possessions in the world, all the kingdoms of the world? It'd be hard to turn that down, wouldn't it? And the devil tempted Jesus in the area of power and possessions, and he will do the same for you and I. God will allow us to be tested in this area. Power and possessions, if you think about it, is what the world lives for. Not just gratifying the flesh, but man, I want more stuff, more money, more authority, more power, sometimes so that I can get more stuff, more possessions, and more power. And we will all be tested in that way. And if we don't pass this test, then it severely hinders our ability to live the gospel out in our lives. And if you think about it, Jesus, he creates this dichotomy. He says in several places, you can't serve both God and money. You can't serve both God and possessions. You can't serve both God and wealth. Now, you think about it. Why does he put special emphasis on you can't serve God and money? Why not you can't serve God and sex? Why not you can't serve God and, I don't know, any other thing? He says you can't serve both God and money. The reason why is because money has a unique grip on us. Possessions and the things that money can buy, it has a unique grip on us. Because if you think about it, if we're trusting in money, then we're not trusting in God to provide, right? If we're trusting in money for security, then we're not trusting in God for security. And you can actually measure that. If I have X amount of dollars in the bank, I feel good and I feel secure. If I don't have X amount of dollars in the bank, then I'm fearful and I'm worried, right? I'm anxious and I'm afraid. If I have X amount of dollars in the bank, then I know that my future is secure and I'm taken care of. And so, and then we don't need God because I'm taken care of. And so it's interesting that the Bible paints this picture that we can't serve both God and we can't serve money at the same time. Jesus was tested in this very way. I will give you all the possessions in the world. I will give you the authority and the riches of every kingdom in the world if you bow down to me. In the Bible, in the book of Malachi, the people of God were under a curse from God because they didn't trust God in this area. And it said, we pick it up here in Malachi chapter 3. The people were under a curse, and the prophet Malachi comes and he speaks to them on God's behalf, and he says this, "Will a man rob God? Yet you are robbing me. But you say, how have we robbed you?" And look at what he says. "In your tithes and your contributions and your offerings. The whole nation of you is under a curse because you've robbed me of this. Bring the full tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house," he says, "and thereby put me to the test." Remember, we're talking about God testing us, but here the Bible says we can test God. "Put me to the test," says the Lord of hosts. The only time he says you can test me. He says this, "And see if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there is no more need. Then all nations will call you blessed, for you will live in a land of delight," says the Lord of hosts. How do we rob God? We rob him in our tithes and offerings. Now, we wrestle with that. You can have a hard time with that, but we got to ultimately square up our lives with Scripture and what the Bible says. And in numerous places, the Bible tells us you can't trust both God and money, and therefore I give you the tithe as an application point to actively trust me. That's really what it is. It's an application point for us to trust God. And if you think about it, the tithe, it biblically means the tenth. And it says that's a tenth of our income, what we earn. The Bible says goes to him. Now, I don't know about you, but I have a hard time with that. Can I be honest? Because every time I look at that tithe check, or now it's automatic, every time I see it come out, I go, man, I could really use that, right? Isn't that true? Anybody else feel that way? Am I the only unholy person in here? You're all looking at me like, what are you talking about? I was sharing with the other service that in about a month span of time, my house racked up about $6,000 worth of expenses. Our water heater went out, and our solar water heater, so I had to fix that. That was about $5,000. And then our refrigerator mysteriously broke. I don't know. Why does it always happen at the same time? That was about $1,000. $1,000 for a refrigerator. That was the cheapest one Lowe's had. Then our garage door opener broke. I had to fix that. That was like $500. And I was just like, oh my gosh, why is this happening? And I was tempted to go, you know what? Maybe we shouldn't tithe this month. You know, I mean, it's like a drop in the bucket, but still. And then my dryer broke, by the way, but I fixed it. I just needed to share that with you because I'm kind of proud of myself. I was going to throw it away, so I was like, if I rip it open, it won't really matter. And I figured out what was wrong, bought the part, and fixed it. I was like, yes. Anyway, but you know, you're tempted in those moments to say, you know what, I'm going to pull back the tithe because, you know, I need it. But here's what the Bible does. It puts us in a place every month or whenever you tithe to really question, who am I trusting in? Am I trusting in God to be my provider or what I see in my bank account? Am I trusting in God to take care of me when times get rough and times get hard, or am I trusting in the almighty dollar to take care of me in those moments? Because you can't serve both God and money. See, it's not money that's the root of all evil. It's the love of money that's the root of evil. When we trust in money in an inordinate way, that's when it becomes the root of evil, because we say, I don't need God anymore because I got it all taken care of. And so when all those expenses came out, I was like, okay, God, you're going to have to figure out a way to provide for us, because that's rough. This is rough. And you know what? Ever since I started tithing about 20 years ago, God has always provided for us. And by the way, I've been in ministry for a while now, and I've never met a person that said, man, I started tithing, and I got screwed by God. Not once. Not once. Here's what you hear, though. I started tithing, and God provided me a promotion. I started trusting God with my finances, and he's taking care of this bill and that situation and that circumstance. And I've always had more than enough. And that's what God wants to do. See, you can make money on your own, but God is the one who's going to provide for you. See, we can earn our wealth, but it's God that gives us the ability to even work. He could take the breath out of our lungs today, and we couldn't go to work tomorrow. He could hinder us from doing what we normally do, and then what would we have? And God wants us to square up with his word every single day and say, I trust in you as my source and my provider. I'm not going to look at power and possessions in the kingdoms of this world to provide for me. It's you that will provide for me. And that's what the tithe does. It forces us to remember every month or every week or whenever you do it that it's God that provides for me. Yeah, we could use that extra 10%. But God says, if you trust me with that 10%, I will take care of your 100%. If you trust me with that 10%, I will take care of 100% of your needs. Test me in this, he says. And I want to encourage us this morning to test him in that. He says test him, so let's test him. Let's be faithful. Let's trust him. Let's honor him and be fully tithing. And see if God will not bless us and take care of us and provide for us. And then when the world looks and says, man, how is it that you're so confident in the midst of recession? How is it that you have so much peace in the midst of economic downturn? We say, because our God is the one that provides for us. It's not the stock market. It's not the Dow Jones Industrial Average. It's not the unemployment report. It's God that provides for me. And it points us to him. It points people who are far from God to him. I want to share this with this statistic with you. The reality is this, about 10 to 25% of any given church actually tithes faithfully. Now that's pretty sad, if you ask me. But watch what would happen if every Christian actually did the very fundamental basic Christian thing and trusted God with their finances. I just want to share a couple of things with you. If every Christian tithe, there would be an excess of $165 billion, okay? $25 billion could relieve global hunger and starvation and deaths from preventable diseases in 5 years. If every Christian just obeyed the Bible, okay? $12 billion could eliminate illiteracy. $12 billion of 165, by the way, could eliminate illiteracy in 5 years. $15 billion could solve the world's water sanitation issues, specifically in places in the world where 1 billion people live on less than $1 a day. Just $15 billion of that 165. $1 billion could fully fund all overseas mission work, and $100 to $110 billion would be left over for additional ministry expansion around the world. We can actually, you know, when Jesus says you can impact the world and you can change the world and you can touch the world, he wasn't blowing smoke. He actually meant it. But in order for that to happen, we actually have to do what this book says to do. And when we do, we can have a real impact in the world, just in the way that we steward our finances. We're all tested in this area. Will we trust him? Or will we bow down to the temptation of Satan and say, yeah, give me those possessions. I'm going to hold on to it. I'm going to keep it for me. Or will we use it for God and trust God with it and see what God will do through it? See, people say, see, the church is all about money. No, the church is all about getting the gospel out to the world. Unfortunately, that requires money. And that's why God allows that. So we can all do this together. It's not just a few people, but it's the entire body, the disciples, the followers of Christ, that together we can have a real impact in the world. Can I hear an amen to that? We're all going to be tested in this area of power and possessions. Will we trust God more than we trust our wealth? Maybe you're tested in that right now. Maybe you don't like me right now. I don't care. It's the Bible, so, you know, whatever. The reality is you're going to serve who you love. And with your resources, you're going to serve who you love with those resources. Will we serve God with them, or will we serve ourselves with them? The third way that we're tested, the way that Jesus was tested, we see it here. After he was tested with power and possession, well, first, let's see what he said. He said, Jesus answered to him, because Satan said, if you worship me, I will give you everything. If you use your life for me, I will give you all these possessions. Jesus said, no, it is written. Notice he comes back with the word again. It is written, love the Lord your God and serve him only. Don't serve money, don't serve wealth, don't serve yourself, serve him. And watch as God takes care of us. Verse 9 is the third temptation. The devil led Jesus to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. So he's telling Jesus, get on top of the temple where everyone can see you. Jump off and let's see if God's angels rescue you like his word says. Jesus answered, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. And when the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. The third way that we are tested is in our identity. We're going to be tested in our identity. Notice it at every temptation, and again here, the devil says, if you really are the Son of God, if you really are a child of God, then let's see what God will do for you. If you really are a child of God, go and stand at the top of the temple and throw yourself off. Let's see if those angels come and rescue you. You know what would have happened if Jesus did that? If he climbed up to the top of the temple and then jumped off, the angels would have caught him, right? And what would have happened? The whole world would have said, oh my gosh, did you see what just happened? Jesus jumped off the temple and the angels caught him. And they would have made him king in Jerusalem way too early. They would have set him up in the temple, he would have been made king, and he would have never went to the cross. You know what would have happened if he never went to the cross? You and I would not ever be able to be saved. Because he had to give his life on the cross as a sacrifice of atonement for you and for I. Now, I don't know about you, but if I was Jesus, that's the last thing I'd want to do. Yeah, go to the cross and die for people. I stub my toe and I'm like done. You know what I mean? I don't want to do nothing else. I can't imagine getting lashed and then nailed to a cross and then being hung up there to asphyxiate and die. I would not want to do that. And the temptation came and said, you don't have to go through that. You're God, aren't you? You don't have to go through that suffering for those people. You don't have to go through that suffering for those sinners. Why would you want to suffer for them? Just throw yourself off the temple. They'll make you king, and you don't have to go through all of that. But here's what Jesus said instead. No. See, here's what you don't understand, Satan, is I am the Son of God, and this is exactly what I do. I give my life for the sinners of the world. See, this is what Satan didn't understand. God is not about himself. God is not about power, possessions, feeding his flesh. He is not about being set up as king. He is about seeking and saving the lost. That's what he is all about. That's why he came. The Bible says Jesus came only to seek and to save the lost. And so when he said, if you really are the Son of God, why don't you prove it and get crowned king? No, I am the Son of God. I'm going to prove it by going to the cross and dying for the world. That's how I'm going to prove who I am. See, we have to understand that when we're tested in our identity, we're usually going to respond to do something to make ourselves better, make ourselves feel better. But if we really are a child of God, then what we do is we do what Jesus did. We give our lives and we live our lives for others. If you really are the Son of God, then I'm going to live my life on mission. I'm going to live my life on purpose. I'm going to serve. I'm going to steward my finances. Man, I'm going to send myself out to share the gospel with the world because I am a child of God. And that's what we do. One of my friends who's an assistant coach at Pearl City is the one that asked me if I wanted to help coach. And, you know, I'm pretty busy, got three kids. The baby was here, and I was like, I don't know if I can do this. You know, there's a lot going on. I don't know if I have time to do this. And I was talking it over with my wife, Naomi, and she said, yeah, you know, you're pretty busy. I don't know how you're going to be able to do this. And then she said, you know, if you start coaching, that's more nights that you're not going to be home with your kids. And you know, that was really hard because, you know, I obviously love my kids, and I like spending time with my kids. My favorite time of the day is when I come home, and then, you know, my son wants to play basketball, or my daughter wants me to play My Little Ponies. I like that just a little bit less than basketball, but, you know, but being around them, you know, I love that. And I thought about it for a moment. Yeah, I don't want to miss those nights. I want to be able to be around more. I don't want to give my time for kids that I don't even know yet out on that field. But as I was praying about it, I felt the Lord say, but isn't this what you do? Isn't this what we're supposed to do? To give our lives not just for our comforts or our family and our security and our needs, but to give our lives to serve the community and those outside the walls of the church? Isn't that what we do? And I felt like I was tempted, just like Jesus was, to just live for myself. And all of us are tempted in that way. Isn't that true? We're all tempted, like, I don't want to go to church on Sunday morning. I like to stay home and watch the Cowboys, you know, or Mariota. You know, I would stay home and watch the Seahawks. I don't want to go to church on Saturday night because St. Louis is playing Kahuku, you know. Pastor Kalai was gloating earlier. But we think, man, I don't want to use my time and my treasure, my talents for others. I need to use it on myself. I need that time to make my life more comfortable and to make my situation more secure and to make myself happier and bring myself more comfort and joy. But then we should be reminded that if we're a child of God, isn't that what we do? We give our lives the way that Jesus gave his life. Just as he laid his life down for me, I'm now called to lay my life down for others. Even when it's inconvenient and it's hard. And it's always inconvenient and hard. But isn't that what we do? See, we're all going to be tested in this area of our identity. If you're a Christian, that we tend to think, man, okay, God's supposed to bless me. He's supposed to make my life better. That's what it's about. No, that's not what it's about. Jesus didn't say it's about me. He said it's about them. It's about you. It's about me. And he gave his life. He didn't set himself up as king. He gave his life as a sacrifice. And he calls us to do the same. And maybe we're not experiencing the fullness of the blessing of God and the purpose of God and the power of his promises at work in our life because maybe we're failing right now in one of these three testings. We're failing in the area of our appetites. We're giving in to the lusts of our flesh. Maybe we're failing in the area of our possessions where it's about us and we're not fully trusting God. Maybe it's in the area of our identity where we're using our lives on ourselves and not using it for others the way that Jesus did for us. We want to challenge us this morning. What would happen if we dared to believe this Bible? What would happen in our family, in our friends, in our communities if we dared to live like Jesus lived? You realize Jesus' early followers in the first century turned the world upside down. Within a few hundred years, the entire Roman Empire became Christian because of the radical way that the disciples lived. What would happen if we were to do that today? And I submit to you, as I said in the very beginning, now more than ever, the world needs to see followers of Christ actually live like Jesus. I think we could have a major, massive impact on the world. Can I hear an amen to that? Amen. See, ultimately, we overcome the enemy's tests when we are rooted in our identity as children of God. And I love this. Right before Jesus was tempted, right before he was led out into the wilderness to be tested in these three ways, just before that, he got baptized in water. And when he was baptized, take a look at this here in Luke chapter 3. Right as he came out of the water, verse 21 says this, now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus had also been baptized and was praying, the heavens were opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven saying, you are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased. Before he was even led to be tempted by the wilderness, he was anchored in who he was as a child of God. So every time the devil came and said, if you are the child of the Son of God, do this. Jesus was like, I am the child of God. I just heard him tell me that. I don't need to give in to your temptations. I don't need to give in to your lies. I don't need to give in to the lust of my flesh because I know who I am. I am a child of God. And I want to ask you this morning, do you know who you are as a child of God? Whenever we fail in the test, it's because we've forgotten who we are. You are a child of God. And every morning we get up, we ought to remind ourselves, because of what Jesus did for me on the cross, I am a child of God. Because of what he's done for me and giving his life for me, I am a child of God. And before we get out the door to go to work or to school or whatever we do it with the idea and the mentality that I am a child of God. And when we live like a child of God in a world that is so dark, light breaks through. Amen? See, the good thing about something, a place that's very dark, is even the slightest bit of light can be blinding. Isn't that true? Even the slightest bit of light will grab your attention. When we live like Jesus out in the world, that little bit of light draws attention to our great God. There's a story I want to close with this morning. And I don't know, how many of you have seen the movie Hacksaw Ridge yet? Hacksaw Ridge? No? All right. Pastor Norman said you can't go to heaven without seeing this movie. So let's all go after this. Because you never know, right? But anyway, Hacksaw Ridge, that's a joke, by the way. You don't go to heaven by seeing a movie, okay? Because of Jesus, just gotta say, okay? But the movie Hacksaw Ridge is a real-life story about a man by the name of Desmond Doss. He was a private in the Army in World War II, and his strong faith in Christ led him to actually be a pacifist. In other words, he didn't want to carry a gun into battle. They call it being a conscientious objector. And he said, because of my faith in Jesus, I don't want to take life, but I want to join the army anyway. He volunteered, by the way, to join the army as a medic so that he could save lives instead of take lives. And long story short, at the end of the day, after a horrific battle in the islands off of Japan, or in the Pacific, he ended up saving anywhere between 75 and 100 people single-handedly as a conscientious observer. Objector, conscientious objector. Desmond Doss, so motivated by his faith, said, I want to go out there and I'm gonna save as many lives as I can. And he crawled through gunfire and he almost single-handedly drags over almost 100 men to safety and lowered them down that infamous ridge called Hacksaw Ridge to safety. And with each run and each person that he saved, he was reportedly heard praying, God, help me get one more. And he'd run back into gunfire and save one more. About 100 times. One of the men that he saved was a man by the name of Captain Jack Glover. And as you saw in the clip there, Desmond Doss went through a whole lot of persecution from his fellow soldiers. They thought he was weak. They thought he was a coward. One of the men that led that and wanted to actually get him out of his unit was Captain Jack Glover. He led the persecution against Desmond Doss. Well, Jack Glover was one of the men that Desmond Doss dragged to safety, as played by Vince Vaughn that you saw in that clip. He saved Jack Glover. One of his fellow soldiers, a man by the name of Carl Bentley, he said he was there, and he said, "It is as if God had his hand on Doss's shoulder. It's the only explanation I can give for what he did." See, here's what I love about this story. He was tested, and he was tested over and over and over again. Before joining the army, he was tested. And then as he was tested by his peers and beaten and tried to get thrown out, and he passed those tests because he knew who he was. And I'm a child of God, and I'm gonna live for God, and I'm gonna live to save other people. And that's exactly what he did. People were alive after that war who should have died because of Desmond Doss. And you know, when we know who we are in Christ, we know whose we are, by the way, that we belong to Jesus, we can live with that same kind of love. Now, thank God we don't have to run through gunfire to pull people out. We just got to run through some temptations, yeah? We just got to run through some hard times, some sacrifices. We have to run through maybe to a coffee shop to have a one-to-one with somebody. We don't have to go through what he went through, but when we know who we are, we'll do whatever it takes to be disciples in this world and let the light of God shine brightly in the midst of darkness. His picture is also a powerful picture of the gospel, because Jesus didn't live his life just to satisfy himself, but he literally left heaven to come to earth to come and rescue you and I. Isn't that true? And in like manner, he says, "What I've done for you, go and do for others." See, we ultimately overcome the enemy's tests because Jesus overcame, and he empowers us to overcome. There are people in your life that God is calling every single one of us to go and run through gunfire to pull out, to pull them into church, pull them into your grace group, pull them into your life for a one-to-one, that we would see their life transformed by the gospel. When we know who we are and we know whose we are, we can live as a disciple of Jesus in this world. Will you bow your heads with me as we come to a close? You're here this morning, and maybe you're walking through some tests right now. You're dealing with some tests in your faith. Maybe it has to do with lust and satisfying your appetites. All of us are tested in that. Maybe right now you're being tested in the area of possessions, and you're tempted to withhold the tithe or not be generous or to use those resources on yourself. We're all tested and tempted in that way as well. Maybe you're here this morning and you're tested and tempted to live in a way inconsistent with the gospel. We've forgotten who we are as children of God. May God help us this morning to overcome the way that Jesus overcame. So Father, we thank you that you are an amazingly loving God. You're patient with us in all of our weaknesses. Jesus, I pray this morning for every single one of my brothers and sisters here, and myself included, that just as you overcame, that we would overcome as well. Holy Spirit, empower us to be like you in the face of temptation, to say no, to quote scripture, and to overcome the temptation of the enemy, knowing that we're children of God, knowing who we are, and that we belong to you, so that we can shine your light in a world that needs to see it. Let us not just talk about the gospel, but let us demonstrate the gospel with our lives. Help us to be that people. And Lord, I pray that even as we go to our family parties this week and throughout the holidays, that we would not argue over politics, but that we would demonstrate the gospel in the world. Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for your patience. Help us to represent you, in Jesus' name. And all God's people say, amen and amen. You know, I just want to challenge us this morning. You know, Pastor Norman did it in the earlier two services, and I want to do it here. We are at a pivot point. That's why this series is called Turning Points. In our nation, like never before, the world needs to see the church, be the church. Not just attend church, but that we'd actually live it out there. That's the hardest thing to do. Right? I know sometimes coming to church on Sunday is the hardest thing to do. It's really not. Being the church out there is the hardest thing to do. Loving our neighbors is the hardest thing to do. Serving them when it gets hard. forgiving them when they need to be forgiven. That's the hardest thing. But it's also the most powerful thing that you and I can do. The world is dark and it needs some light. You are that light to your coworkers, your family, and your friends. Let's be that, especially now. Amen.
Thanks for joining us. Visit our website at pearlside.org for more.